Hi, it's Angela Valentrumeo. This is Colliding Worlds. We're at the Palm Springs Fine Art Fair, and we are with Daniel Stern. He may look familiar to you, says his life as an actor, but we're more interested in his life as an artist.
Welcome to Colliding Worlds. I'm your host, Angela Valentrumeo. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
I'm loving this, the bronze.
Oh, thank you.
Is this a passion, second career, what you always wanted to be when you grew up?
Yeah, you know, probably just a continuation of my life. I think I've been an artistic kid my whole life, you know, and I mean, when I was young, I did sculpture, I did pottery, I had built a potter's wheel in my basement. I've always loved that and theater and all sorts of artistic endeavors. I sort of went down the showbiz path, which has been satisfying in a lot of ways. My artistic, whatever's inside, you know, you need to express. I have three kids that I finally got rid of. They're all up and on their way. It gave me some time to do other things with my time.
It's great to do when they leave the nest.
Oh, it's beautiful. And they're all flapping their wings and they're all doing great. I got a lawyer, a doctor, and a musician, so that's pretty
good.
Yeah, I did good.
We have one that's quasi-flapping their wings.
Yeah, it takes a little while. It takes longer. I mean, I was out of the house. I dropped out of high school at 17 and moved to New York to be an actor, actually. So these kids take a heck of a long time to get rolling. But the sculpture is really just a kind of a need. I wonder if, like I said to my wife, I said, it's either a business deduction or it's a mental health deduction. I'm not sure, because I really need to do it.
There's got to be a line for it on that schedule. Yeah, right.
Somewhere. Because I love the sculpting. I'm in control. I can do it every day. Acting and directing, you know, those things come along when they come along, and it's beautiful. I love doing all that stuff. But this is really my my life.
They're figures.
Yeah.
Are all your sculptures figural?
I've done a little bit of abstract stuff, mostly, yeah. I'm, you know, it's a similar continuation of my acting life. I'm creating characters. I'm creating moments. There's something in the films that I work on. I try to get a reality and try to touch an emotion that other people have felt before, or a scene, or a moment. And sometimes I think of these as like a little frame of film.
When you start your pieces, do you start from clay? Do you start from a drawing? Where does it start from?
I can't. If I could draw, it would be so much simpler. If I could paint, I know, and it's very, very frustrating. So I start with clay. I mean, I do everything in clay. I get an image or a pose or a moment or a feeling that I'm going for, and I just start. And I used to sculpt in plaster. Like, I'd build an armature, you know. I mean, the armature is the inside, the metal infrastructure to keep it. So I would make the, and then I'd do plaster. And plaster was very, very unforgiving. I mean, you know, and when you, like, oh, I want his arm to be at a slightly different angle, you have to hack it. And when I moved to the clay, it's been very freeing, because I can do exactly what I want to do. And if I make a mistake, I found myself chasing my mistakes in the plaster work. Bigger pieces I make. I've done some monumental, like, 8-9 foot pieces, you know. And that, too, I make an armature. And I'll start packing clay on the thing. So when I actually finally get done, now I've put clay on this structure, now I take the sculpture. It was very scary, actually, the first time I did it, because the first one I did in bronze was a big piece. So the first thing they do is they chop it up.
Yes.
They cut the friggin' arms off the thing, and I was going, are you kidding? I just spent 3 months, like, making sure everything, and he's like, but they need to, because what they're going to do is make a mold of a piece. Him, I could probably do in one piece, although the stick is going to be a separate piece. But
right. But
they'll make a mold of it with silicone, and then they'll take the mold away. Now you have a mold of the piece. And in order to get to bronze, it's called the lost wax process. Yes. So should I explain?
Yeah, it's really interesting how that works, because most people think that you just take whatever this and you...
Yeah, or that you're hammering in bronze. Everybody said, how do you make
backyard.
A bronze, you know, and it's like, yeah, I didn't know.
Lost wax is really interesting, and you have a mold.
Right.
So if there's a mistake,
You can do a little bit of fixing. You can make another one, but inside that, if once I make a mold and it's a silicone mold, now they fill that mold with wax. And when you take the mold away, there's a wax guy of this. And now you take the wax guy of this and they roll it in sand, a very, very fine sand that will get into every core and nook and cranny. And then they'll do that the first day, then it dries. Second day, they do it for 3 weeks. They roll it deeper and deeper and deeper into thicker and thicker, more coarse, until he's encased in cement. Now we have a wax version of him in cement. And when it's done and hard, now there's a hole in the top. They take the molten bronze, they pour the molten bronze in, the wax melts and comes out the bottom hole. And inside there now is my walking man in bronze. He's filled that space. And with the bigger ones, with the lady that they chop the arms off of, now we do that in each piece. We make a mold, wax of each piece. And when they're all done, we weld it back together, grind the seams, then work on the patinas. It's a process.
It's not like, poof, there it is. But the detail that you're able to get.
Oh, it's beautiful.
You know, I mean, sometimes you can, if you were working in plaster, I'm not sure you would get as fine of the detail as you see here. And there's a reclining figure that's also here at the show, the detail in the sneakers.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
Yeah, I was looking at those friggin' sneakers forever.
And your dreams,
yeah,
you know?
Right, exactly. It's crazy how obsessed you can get.
Well, I got obsessed with these two, the figures behind us.
I wanted to challenge myself a little bit and say, okay, now I can do things that feel real to me. Now, how do I stretch myself? How do I change dynamics? How do I change, I'm not ready to go fully abstract, but I can abstract the figurative. And I said, how do I stretch myself? I said, well, let's just stretch it. You know, and I sort of got that kind of long feeling. But this one, actually, I started with her, and I was thinking of my daughters, actually, in that just sort of a proud, strutting, reaching for the glory, you know, and just, I thought, I found it just sort of empowering. I don't know, that was the inspiration for that with my daughters. And then, actually, this one I was thinking of, you know, I saw the Arab Spring, and I see these kids throwing rocks, and the passion that they have to be able to stand up to the authorities that, and just throw a rock at them, inspired me, you know, and I just wanted to, again, have that kind of, that big wind up and that, I don't know, just that they're willing to do that.
The intensity in the face. There's very much an intensity in that face. And you can sort of see his muscles straining. Like,
yeah.
I'm going to throw that.
I'm going to throw this. And I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but I have to. People have been making art since the beginning of time. It's as natural an instinct as eating and sleeping and procreating. I mean, a lot of great ways to interact is verbal. We're having a great conversation, but there's other ways to communicate, and art is one of the most universal and basic and historical, I mean, since prehistory.
You don't need to speak the language, you just need to be able to see it.
That's where I found the connection with my acting life and my storytelling life of the movies and television, is that I'm still, those stories have to be told. I am a storyteller by nature, I don't know. And these are stories, little glimpses, little frames of a movie that are of stories that I need to tell. And they're hard to even, you know, to talk to you and verbalize it. It feels strange because they're not really verbal stories. They're bronze stories or they're sculpted stories. So it's interesting, but I have those stories I have to tell. And what kid hasn't picked up a crayon and said, here's mommy and daddy in a car and we're driving to the grocery store. And I also love what you said, that we're all artists. That's the thing, as a kid again. And I have a kid, I have a lawyer, brainiac dude, I have a doctor, but then I have a musician. And like, to have raised this kid and go, oh, the first one, he went to Harvard. You know, I got this brainiac kid. I'm a high school dropout. I had a brainiac kid. It's like, oh yeah, that's how kids are raised, I see. The next one comes along, she's not that. There was no chance of her being anything but an artist. And I was lucky enough to have had an artistic life that I could say, yes, let's nurture that, as opposed to, oh, you're trying to screw off, you're just a goofball, just do the homework and, you know, move on, you know? Because I think a lot, and my son's a great artist, the lawyer's a great artist, and the doctor's a great artist. They're all good artists, and we try to encourage that side of them too, because they need that art just as much as the artist needs the art. The lawyer needs to come home and do something else.
I used to be a lawyer, and it's like, so it's been nice to have that outlet. But,
yes.
But it was also nice to, it's also nice when the artist's seen for what it is, and that to nurture that along, and that's what we need. We need more people like you to nurture the generation next, and well, we need more people like you to create. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
We've been with Daniel Stern. We're looking at his art. We're hearing what he has to say. You know him as an actor, now know him as an artist. Thank you so very much.
Thanks, it was a pleasure, yeah.
Hi, I'm Brett Philpott. AIDS Life Cycle is a thrill to participate in. So many of people have lost friends, loved ones, fathers, mothers, sons to AIDS, and they're all getting on these bikes and they're riding to help find the cure. But I do want to admit, it is a lot of work. And I can't do it though unless I also have the contributions towards AIDS Life Cycle. AIDS Life Cycle is an organization that is here to help with the pandemic of AIDS and those living with HIV. The beneficiaries of this are the San Francisco AIDS Foundation and the Los Angeles Gay and Lesbian Center. The money used from this event is there to help with AIDS prevention, AIDS education, and those living with HIV with their medicines and their food and their lodging and things that they can't do for themselves necessarily anymore, and our government agencies don't have the money to fund. I am riding my bicycle from San Francisco to Los Angeles next June 2nd through June 8th in AIDS Life Cycle Ride, and I need your support. And we must help those that can't afford to help themselves in this dreadful pandemic. Please, find it in your heart, send out some love, whether it's small or large. I have lots of incentives, I'm giving away paintings, and I appreciate everything that you and I can do for those other than ourselves. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Dory, and this is my room. I'm a metal artist, I cut metal, I weld, and now I do powder coating. These are spires that I just finished just a couple days ago. These are gonna get a sphere on top. It's gonna have two colors, and they'll be on a base. These are the bases.
You indicated earlier we've been looking at, and it's wild. You have to see this place. It's just amazing. You're starting to work with color.
Color, I know.
And how has that changed how you look at metal?
I don't make art anymore. I just make things to put color on now.
How did you get started? What brought you to metal?
I've always been fascinated by metal. I have a piece of paper over there that I wrote when I was 7. It says, when I grow up, I'm going to be a steel or iron maker. Bless my mom for saving that.
That's wild. Are these being made for somebody, or you're just doing
them? I'm just making them.
Do a lot of your work, is it just, it comes to you, you make it, and then you...
I do work, and I sell a few pieces a year, and a few people come in here a year and buy it. I do a lot of commissions, because people see this stuff. And then I can do fireplaces, I can do gates and doors and stairs and numbers. And my life is so simple now. Either I'm out here working, or else I'm waiting to get out here and work. There's very little in between.
What are the tools that you use? Because I make jewelry. My tools are nowhere near as big as all yours.
This is the cutting table. This is my number one tool. There's a couple saxophones on here right now. Oh, good, I can get it out. There's a saxophone.
Now you cut each piece.
Yes.
On this machine. So
yes.
Are you cutting, is it laser cutting? Is it cutting by hand?
Plasma cutting.
Mm-hmm.
I just drew this yesterday. I made a smaller one too. This is gonna get glass in all the holes. One is going to a friend of mine who's gonna mount it on a plaque. Smaller one there, I'm gonna finish both sides and try to make it dimensional and then powder coat it. And we'll see what happens. I want to do a series of musical instruments.
Are you a musician?
At one time I was. I could never cut this one. Oh, that's why I got stuck. You know, I could never cut two like this identical, smaller, by hand. Never. No way ever. This thing, this changed my life, getting this one.
How long have you been using a plasma cutter to do your work?
Well, I was using the plasma cutter before I bought a CNC controlled plasma cutter. I've been using a plasma cutter for maybe 15 years or something like that.
And that's what allows you to get all of this.
But I've only had this machine for maybe 8 years.
You have other neat tools in here that let you work. You've got a big sandblaster.
Hang on, I just spent even more money for a bigger one.
Oh my goodness.
No kidding, that's what I said.
And this is where you can powder coat and get this cool color.
I powder coat in the other room here. There's some chairs in the oven right now.
That you're powder coating?
They're ready to come out if you want to see them.
Yes.
Okay. So this is the powder coating area. I'm going to open up this room and pull the chairs out. I have no idea how this finish is going to be.
Surprise!
Yes.
This is so cool.
These are warm, so don't touch them.
Wow.
Yeah, no kidding. Look at these things. Well, they'll cool down in a few hours. There's so much mass here.
Yeah, how long were they baking?
They
so
have
to
get up to 400 degrees for 10 minutes.
Yeah. How small can you powder coat? What's the smallest thing and the largest thing?
The largest is 6x6x4. This is the largest I've done so far.
It's wild.
Those are really, really heavy.
Now, how do you go about powder coating something?
These are the powders. It's actually, you know, it's physical powder that you put on. It's applied electrostatically. This is the control unit for the gun. This puts a charge on whatever you're powder coating. This is where it all happens. But you hang your piece or wheel your piece in and connect it up. And then your gun has another charge. Your powder goes in this hopper and just poofs out of the hose with barely any pressure. And it just zaps to the piece and it clings to it. The residue of the air is always going through here. Goes through there and gets clean.
You have other pieces here. Talk to me about some of the ones you have. You've got mailboxes, which are fascinating. You have just these abstract pieces.
In another life, on the north side of Chicago, I used to make mailboxes. I had a partner who could sell them. We sold mailboxes to people with bazillion-dollar houses. I had a spot up, place in the merchandise mart in Chicago. I was on TV on a show called Handy Ma'am.
Huh.
It was fun.
There's some really beautiful pieces now. When you look out, everywhere you look, there is something. There's a mailbox, there's staircases, there are these chairs, there's smaller items. What do you like making? Is it?
I just like making stuff. I love making tools for this stuff. Trish said that the art is merely a front. That actually what I make is tools, like, you know, the cart.
Is she like to talk to my husband, Mark? Mark says the only reason I have jewelry is so I can buy another tool.
I made all this stuff, these tools. I made the dies that make the spheres and all that. I just love to make tools.
The spheres that we're... They're really magnificent. Do you use a hydraulic press?
Yes. I use this die right here.
Thor.
This is the one I was going to show you with your finger. Put your finger right here. This is a hydraulic press. This gives 65 tons. I cut the shape, arrows, dogs, whatever the shape is that I'm going to make a sphere out of. I put this piece inside. And then this squeezes, puts the radius in whatever piece of metal that I'm going to do.
Have you ever made a piece you just could never part with?
No. These are all soldiers in the war against poverty.
I love it.
And I do not like them hanging around here.
Find them home.
Unlike many artists, you know, like, when I'm done with them, it's like, get out of here.
It's like children, leave the nest.
Yeah, out, ooh, out. Fly. They do me no good hanging here other than, you know, they'll bring in, people will see them. I know that I can make stuff, but...
This is really amazing. You don't have a website, but we'll give people some idea of where to find you. I'm amazed. I'm so happy this was something to stumble upon, and it was a great thing to stumble upon. The work is amazing. The colors are so cool. I am so looking forward to seeing the two-toned. I can, I'm waiting for something,
really?
You know, it'd be so cool. I'm amazed at what you've created here and the beautiful work you've done. And I want to thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks. This has been really an adventure. It's been a real colliding world, and I'm glad you were here for it. Hi, this is Angela Valenti-Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds, and we are in the studio of Patrick Blythe. He works in glass, in bronze, and all kinds of amazing things. He's got this wonderful piece that's going down on El Paseo, and we're going to learn a little bit more about him. We're going to learn a little bit more about the piece, and we're going to learn a lot more about what he does. Come along with us, and we'll take you on another journey. So how long have you been in this spot?
I started this in about May, got serious about the work, and the city of Indio has made this possible, and it's just a wonderful facility. We have 17,000 square feet total, mm-hmm. So there's a lot of room for creativity.
How did you get involved with glass?
It came late in life. I did sculpture and pointillist painting in the early 70s. And then I put that aside. I was so obsessive about my art, I didn't want to eat or communicate with other people or do anything other than paint. When I was doing painting, particularly with the pointillist painting, it's all about color and light. And with glass, you can get a purity of color that is unlike any other medium. And what light brings to the piece when it's in glass is just fabulous. It's about more than just line and color. It's also about refraction and reflection and the transmission of light. I'll wake up in the morning and I'll see a particular sunrise that just totally captivates me. And so I'll do a very brief sketch, really just create some areas of color. And then I'll cut glass to do that. A piece like First Light takes 4,000 little slivers of glass, all cut by hand. And they're arranged in a particular way. They're put in the kiln, they're taken back out. They're reoriented and put back in again, and then I induce movement into the kiln to try to get just the result that I want.
You have a piece, a sculpture that's been accepted and will be part of the El Paseo here in Palm Desert. Talk to me about this piece, and I'm seeing it in three different mediums, and obviously it's not going to be glass and wax on El Paseo necessarily. It's going to be something more substantial. The name of this piece is?
Harvest.
And what prompted you to create this piece?
It's very autobiographical, and one of the things I like working with clay, which is how this started, is that things just seem to emerge from the clay. I don't work from sketches. I don't go into it with a preconceived notion about what I'm doing, but things just seem to emerge. When I grew up, we worked in the fields a lot as small children, and one of the things we'd do is follow the corn picker through the cornfields. And when agriculture was first mechanized back in the 50s and 60s, they kind of went away from horses in the rural area where I lived. The machines weren't very efficient, and so kids like my brother and I could go behind the machinery and pick up the corn the machine didn't get. And then we'd take it home and we'd put it in a corn sheller and grind it through that so the cob comes out one way and the kernels another. And we could load that up in our wagons and get on our bicycles and pull our wagon to the grain elevator. And they'd treat us like adults, like we were any other farmer waiting in line to unload our crop. And then when my dad would get home at night, he'd say, "I heard you boys were at the grain elevator today." So this piece has a lot of things like the tread on the tractor tires and the bags and things that we would use and some of the gear teeth from the grinding equipment. And there's a sense of striving and leaning forward in this that I really enjoy, and also being pressured by the sun. I've had people that have bought these pieces and they see the Virgin Mary in there, or they see a cross, and it kind of invites their own interpretation. One woman sees a trained seal, and all those are valid, whatever they want to find in it is fine with me. When I do it in clay, then I make a mold and I make it in wax. And then I'll revise it a little bit in wax. That's one of the nice things about the process I have is that you get the luxury of time. There's a few steps in the process and you're able to modify it with each step. So after I make it in wax, I'll make a refractory plaster mold and melt the wax out in the lost wax process, time-honored tradition, and I'll make a version in glass.
How do you make a version in glass?
Just with lost wax, just like you would do bronze, except I do it in the kiln.
So it's not slumping at that point. You're taking the glass and you're actually bringing it to a liquid
Yes.
state.
And then when that comes out, then I carve it a lot. One of the nice things about glass is you can get an incredibly sharp edge. You can really learn a lot just in the step of the process of making it in glass. And I like it in glass. If I went no further, I would absolutely love this piece. That's why nobody's ever seen this. I've never had it out.
It's beautiful. So
after I get it in bronze, I can actually do it from the wax or the glass as well. And sometimes they prefer the wax, but they scan it with a laser. And they take thousands of data points, and all that's fed into a computer. And then the computer can drive a giant milling machine. So for the version of Harvest we're working on now, they bought a block of foam that is the size of a small room. And then over a period of a week, the computer controls this milling machine and carves this out of foam. And so once that's done, then it's cast in bronze.
Cast from the foam.
But as prepared as I thought I was to see Harvest in a large scale, it was a very emotional experience. And I had to step away. I spent about 15 minutes with the piece and I had to go out of the building and leave for an hour and try to gather myself up and go back and face that work.
Was it the idea that you had done it or just the emotional part? Because when you look at it, it's a lot of you into it, is it? Or is it a combination?
Part of it is when it is larger than me, you look up at it rather than look down at it. It's not something that you can just form with your hands anymore. And it's almost like it's a being that's never existed that you brought into the world. And it is quite a remarkable thing. Working in my glass, I was somewhat constrained because I felt like I had to do everything myself. That was the time-honored tradition of artists. I had to do everything. And then I worked with an artist, Michael Petrie, at the Palm Springs Art Museum, who had just written a book called The Art of Not Making.
It's a wonderful book.
It is. For me, it was a revelation, and it allowed me to let go and to have other people assist me in the work. If not for that, I would never do bronze. I can't create a foundry here in the studio. And you know, when we think about it, most of the work that we admire wouldn't exist without that approach. We think of Michelangelo, at least the movie version of Charlton Heston suffering under the ceiling and paint dripping in his eyes and all that. The reality is he had 12 assistants. So there's a lot of tradition behind having help.
I want to thank you for your time and bringing us into the studio. It's beautiful.
Thank you. You're one of my first guests here, and I've enjoyed having you. So
thank you so much.